Ça marche.
If you have questions or comments, we will invite you to raise your hands and also speak to the microphone. Otherwise, the people on Zoom will not be able to hear you, the people in the space neither. Finally, I'll just note that we are recording and live streaming this event, and I'll pop those links in the chat for those of you joining via Zoom or listening via YouTube. So feel free to make comments there as well. It's now my pleasure to pass the floor over to Professor and Concordia Research Chair in Climate Science and Sustainability, Professor in Geography, Planning and Environment, Damon Matthews. Over you, Damon.
Okay, thank you, Anna. Can everybody hear me before I go any further? Excellent. So welcome to this experiment at a hybrid event. For those of you on Zoom, I know you can see a row of empty chairs on one of the screens. That's actually behind the main screen that we are sitting at, and we have about 15 or 20 students who have joined us in person at the event, along with Cecile and Sarah, who are here now. So thank you. It's a fun experiment. We'll see how it goes. Now, if I can remember how to use Zoom as I'm actually speaking to real people, I will just get my presentation loaded up. So welcome, everybody. So I'm going to speak for just a couple minutes to introduce the program, and then I will let those of us who are either in person or a couple on Zoom say a few words. We will then have a series of presentations from some of our students, some of the students who went through the first year of the program in an entirely Zoomed experience, and now a few of are here in person, and we'll give a short presentation about their experience and their research. And then we will have a little bit of time for questions, and depending on how the time goes, we may divide up into some breakout rooms to allow you to interact a bit more closely and also offer some ideas or feedback for the program going forward. So this program started last year. In a sense, this is now the first full year of the program. This is a program funded by NSERC and involving the four Montreal universities, and also in very close partnership with Future Earth and Sustainability in the Digital Age, which I will let LIEN introduce very briefly. The idea of this program is to bring together communities of researchers around the ideas of sustainability, global sustainability, and in particular, trying to mobilize the very substantial innovation going on in the digital sector right now, and allow those skills and experiences to contribute to the societal transformations that we need in order to drive change towards meeting global sustainability goals. So the program is really aimed at developing skills in students and researchers, and I would include myself in that. I have learned certainly a lot over the last year in terms of what is possible to do and how we might work towards the changes that are needed across the board. The program, in a sense, can be organized into different themes. Climate is obviously a predominant issue that organizes a lot of research these days. It's not the only sustainability goal. And so you can think of, you know, scientific approaches or systems-based approaches to advancing, you know, all of the sustainable development goals as one of the key themes of this program. And then kind of a cross-cutting theme is this idea of enabling digital innovation to drive progress towards those goals. The program itself, those of you who have been through the first year, I may have a sense already. Those of you who are new, you know, we have a series of activities and opportunities that are part of the program. The, you know, internships are a big component. I think 7 or 8 students this past year went through internships with Future Earth and sustainability in the digital age this past year. Several have done internships in other partners as well. We had a very successful summer school that we held back in May, which we will do again. We are working to include leadership training, particularly the ideas, some of the ideas around collective leadership as opposed to individual leadership. This is, you know, how do you act as a leader, you know, and mobilize groups of people in order to draw on everyone's expertise and work towards common goals. Also, taking this idea and also thinking about how you can do that in a digital space, and drawing on the kind of collective intelligence of people around the world, using digital platforms to explore how you can take that expertise and move forward towards solutions. We will have a seminar and a workshop series that will progress throughout the year. The first one will be later this month, and I'll let Normand Mousseau, who I think is on the call somewhere, speak to that a little bit later. And then finally, the idea of connecting research to international policy convenings. And, you know, we are in a new world now, and it's unclear at what point we will start traveling and going to international meetings again, but there are and continue to be a lot of online opportunities for this as well. And partly via the connections that Future Earth brings to the program, there should be opportunities for participants in the program to engage in some of these opportunities over the coming year. So obviously everyone has seen pictures of these like this. This was our summer school. We were quite fortunate to have guests from Climate Change AI who came and ran 2 days of the summer school, specifically around learning machine learning techniques and how those could be applied to challenges like climate change. This is our team. You know, many of us are here today. I won't kind of speak to everybody, but I would encourage everyone to have a look at the website if you haven't already, and you know, get in touch with the people in the program that are of interest to you. So finally, I'll leave it there by way of introduction. And what I'd like to do to begin or next is to introduce Eliane Ubaliduro, who is the Executive Director of Sustainability in the Digital Age and the head of the Montreal Canadian Global Hub of Future. And so I believe Eliane is on Zoom somewhere. And would you like to introduce yourself and speak a little bit about the role of Future Earth in this program and how you see that going forward?
Thank you, Damon. So can you hear me properly? Okay, excellent. So it's a real pleasure for me to be here today. I've loved working with LIEN-D, and just to give some background for some of you who may not know about Future Earth and sustainability in the digital age. So Future Earth is a global community working to accelerate sustainability transformation. And it's really an honor to be part of the LIEN-D Answer Create. So at Future Earth, what we do is really harness the experience and reach of thousands of scientists and innovators from across the globe to facilitate research, mobilize networks, and spark innovation and turn knowledge into action. And so with sustainability in the digital age, we convene expertise that doesn't normally interact, and we connect the interface of digital innovation, sustainability science, and equity to promote cross-scale collaboration. So for us, being part of LIEN-D has been an excellent opportunity to really contribute to environmental leadership capacity building for early researchers. And this is something that we see that is really needed to accelerate the work towards achieving the SDGs. This aligns perfectly with the need to grow the necessary cross-disciplinary interactions at the interface of sustainability and digitalization to move us towards a nature-positive economies worldwide and that leverage natural, produced social and human capital. And so with the urgency of the last few years and COVID-19, it really has served us to understand the urgency of our interconnection. And the LIEN-D program is really what I would say, a pioneering program in terms of promoting collaborative distributed leadership. And it's only as we interconnect that we're really going to be able to tackle the multiple crises we're facing today. So what I see is that our capacity to interact today and over the years to come are really dependent on the digital world. And so this is one of the things we've loved about having LIEN-D interns, as they have participated in a number of projects for us. One is the Reimagining Climate Governance in the Digital Age, where the interns have been able to interact with the United Nations Environmental Program, sustainability LIEN-D from many of the big tech companies in Silicon Valley. Through the Coalition for Digital and Environmental Sustainability, we've had LIEN-D interns interacting also with the UN Tech Envoy's office, as well as the United Nations Development Program, the International Science Council, the German Environmental Agency, as well as the Kenyan Ministry of Environment. So we continue to work with LIEN-D intern. We're currently running a program on landscape analysis of carbon and water in Canada. And we have benefited from LIEN-D interns who have supported us in major analysis of nature-based solutions in Canada, how to make them more effective in terms of including Indigenous populations, and how do we better link nature-based solutions and machine learning and AI in terms of how do we really allow Canada to be a leader in the space of how we're moving effectively with impact to net zero. So I've been really excited. We've had amazing interactions with the LIEN-D interns. We look forward to having more LIEN-D interns. I've had a pleasure of speaking at the summer school on leadership, and I look forward to more ways of interacting with LIEN-D and just the, it's been a pleasure to interact with Damon and all the other advisors on the advisory group for the LIEN-D program. So just a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Damon. I'll pass it back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Eliane. Maybe I'll turn it over to Sarah Turner, who we have sitting across from me. Sarah is one of the co-PIs in the LIEN-D program. I'm coming from the field of ecology and animal behavior. Maybe once you figure out the microphone, you can just say a few words about.
Is it on?
A few words about what's going on in your group and how your students have participated in the program over the past year.
Yeah, thanks. Apparently, it's been a while since I've interacted in real life. this is fun. It's fun to be in a hybrid meeting with real people in person and also everybody who's here via Zoom. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Geography, Planning and Environment here at Concordia. And our group, the Primatology and Interdisciplinary Environmental Studies Lab, looks at animal behavior and human-animal relationships, and in particular, how animals are responding to human-induced environmental change in a lot of different forms. So we've been really excited to participate in LIEN-D Create over the last couple years, running up to the start last year and having students participating last year in the program. So I'm a primate behavioral ecologist by training, and I work mostly with Japanese macaques, a free-ranging group in Japan that experiences a high rate of congenital limb malformation or physical impairment in the infants. And we don't really know what's causing these physical impairments and the high rates that they're occurring, but it fundamentally comes down to humans and our relationship with this species and with this group and the environment. Teratogens in their food or the environment could be a cause, but also this is a small isolated population that's isolated geographically on an island, and there's likely inbreeding going on as well. So I have students who have worked there and are working there with me. Brogan Stewart is using fractal analysis techniques to examine behavioral complexity in Japanese macaques under different environmental conditions. So at Awajishima, where I work, and in other locations as well. And we've had students who look at movement and space use among those monkeys. And also this year, Ariana Moyne Canary will be looking at those same kinds of patterns with squirrels locally, the pandemic having forced us to broaden our horizons in terms of available models. We also have Yisa Ginath-Yu, who's been modeling climate change and the habitats of our closest relatives, the great apes in Central Africa. And Stephanie Eccles, who's been in the group also in the last year, looking at sustainability in animal agriculture in relation to climate change. And then this year, two new students also, Caroline Lassange, who's here. Hi. And is examining human-animal conflict and interaction among river otters and small communities on the coast of BC. And Jack Cregan will hopefully be able to go to Brazil and study the behavior of an endangered species of blonde capuchin. And also, I'm expecting learn about decolonizing conservation processes. So it's a dynamic group, and that's kind of our fit in Leeds. And we've been really excited to participate. And I'm looking forward to the newest cohort of master students who will be participating starting this year. So thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. So one of the features of the program also is that, you know, we are in Montreal. We are trying to work with our local researchers and our local communities, and our local community is also bilingual. And so I would invite everybody to speak in the language of your choice. And maintenant, Cécile, je vous passe pour parler un peu bien du côté de l'assessment de cycle de vie, et tu peux parler un peu de ton rôle dans le programme.
Merci beaucoup, Damon. J'en profite, oui, je peux parler en français. Donc, je suis ici, je suis très, très heureuse d'être ici en présentiel pour échanger avec vous tous. Donc, moi, je suis ici avec plusieurs chapeaux. Le chapeau du CIREG, donc experte en analyse environnementale du cycle de vie, donc tout ce qui est la compréhension des impacts environnementaux. Donc, la digitalisation, c'est quelque chose qui nous intéresse beaucoup. On parle beaucoup de données, de modélisation des impacts, mais aussi un chapeau CIROD, donc tout ce qui est opérationnalisation du développement durable et interdisciplinarité. Et je pense qu'on est dans un environnement qui favorise vraiment l'interdisciplinarité. Puis le chapeau de l'Institut des sciences de l'environnement de l'UQAM, où également l'interdisciplinarité et l'opérationnalisation sont très, très importantes. Donc, à tous ces titres-là, je pense que pour les étudiants de l'UQAM, du CIREG, du CIROD, c'est une superbe opportunité de pouvoir participer à ce programme LIEN-D. Et la façon dont mes recherches s'inscrivent dans LIEN-D, c'est vraiment la question de comment est-ce qu'on profite de cette ère numérique. Et puis, ces derniers temps, on en a vu vraiment beaucoup plus de possibilités. Je pense que la pandémie nous a offert quand même quelques opportunités en termes de potentiel. Je trouve ça formidable qu'un programme sur la durabilité à l'ère du numérique commence 100% en virtuel. Ça a été pas par choix, mais finalement, on a vu qu'on arrivait à fonctionner ensemble, et je trouve ça puissant aussi de voir tout ce qu'on a réussi à faire et la dynamique qu'on a réussi à créer dans ce contexte-là. Et puis donc, regarder le potentiel du numérique pour la transition durable et regarder aussi les enjeux que le numérique apporte en termes d'impact environnementaux. Donc, c'est un petit peu ça. Et puis, on a plusieurs étudiants, justement, de l'UQAM, du CIREG, qui se sont inscrits dans ce programme-là, et on est très, très heureux de pouvoir être ici avec vous.
Merci, Cécile. So I'm going to quickly pass to a couple of people on Zoom. So we have Graham McDonald, who is another co-PI in the program. No students in the program the first year, but I think three starting as of September. So maybe you can give a quick pitch for what's going on in your group at McGill.
Great, thanks very much, Damon. And it's really a pleasure to be here with all of you today via Zoom. So I'm an associate professor in the Department of Geography at McGill. My research and the research that is done in our group broadly relates to food system sustainability and resilience, and also agriculture as one component of that. So we can think about food systems as all the different ways that we're connected to the food that we eat. That can be starting in the farm fields and what we're growing, how we're growing it, all the way through distribution channels, those complex logistics and trade routes that are needed in some cases to get our foods to our plates, and all the way through to what we're eating. So what are our diets? How do we feel about that? Are we wasting food? And questions like that. Just a little snapshot of some of the types of questions that students in our group are working on, and some of the issues that I'm thinking a lot about as well. We could think about how cities are fed. So what are those food supply chains that are involved in getting food from farms to increasingly cities? So the majority of the world's population lives in cities now. In Canada, it's 80% of people live in urban areas. So how can we understand those food supply chains? What are some of the risks and opportunities involved in those? And so actually that's some work that Zainab Shamas, who's here today, is starting to think about as she starts in the LIEN-D program and PhD at McGill. And also Kirsten Schreiber, an existing PhD student in our lab, has been thinking about quite a bit. That can carry over into rural-urban interactions in terms of food and agriculture. So how can we think about local foods here in Montreal, for example? In our group, we often also think a lot about how materials are cycling through society. So actually that relates somewhat to some of the ideas that Cecile mentioned. We can think about that in one unit of currency that we're particularly focused on in our group is thinking about nitrogen and phosphorus. So different plant nutrients that are really critical for agriculture, but also have major sustainability challenges in terms of pollution. So that's something that Shabelle McCourt, who is here today, has been working on a lot in her PhD research. And then more generally, just thinking about how agriculture is changing over time. So we can think about questions like, how are we using the land to produce food? That's one of the most important sustainability challenges we face today. And I'll just highlight here some work that Erin Gleason, who's starting in the LIEN-D program this year, is starting to think about in her master's, which will look at agro-biodiversity globally over time. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Graham. Dernièrement, avant qu'on passe aux présentations des étudiants, je vais demander à Normand Mousseau de parler pour juste quelques minutes. Il y a un autre copier dans le programme et qui vont aussi nous donner notre première conférence de cette année dans quelques semaines.
Merci, Damon. C'est un plaisir d'être ici. Je suis vraiment désolé de ne pas être en personne, mais bon, la prochaine fois, j'espère. Alors, avant de commencer, je veux quand même souligner le prix Nobel de physique annoncé aujourd'hui. Le prix Nobel de physique, en fait, touche directement le sujet d'aujourd'hui. C'est sur la complexité, modélisation de la complexité. Donc, il y a Giorgio Parisi, qui est un physicien statisticien, qui a eu la moitié du prix Nobel pour ses travaux en complexité et système des ordonnées, mais les deux autres Siyukuro Manabe et Klaus Hasselmann l'ont pour la modélisation du climat et donc la capacité donc, à reproduire les enjeux climatiques. Donc, on se retrouve vraiment dans le sujet, un prix Nobel en physique qui est dans le thème de ce projet de recherche donc, et de formation. Donc, je pense que c'est très, très intéressant de voir qu'on s'inscrit vraiment dans des transformations importantes aujourd'hui et des thèmes majeurs. Mes travaux, je m'intéresse beaucoup à l'énergie, modélisation énergétique, transition énergétique. Donc, je n'ai pas d'étudiants pour le moment, on a des places. Donc, si ça vous intéresse, on a des projets à la fois sur la modélisation des trajectoires de décarbonation. On a aussi des projets, donc du développement de modèles, du développement de la modélisation, aussi dans le transport, l'étude de modélisation du transport associée avec la chaire en transformation du transport, pilotée par Bernard Gendron et quelques autres collègues à qui je suis associé. Donc, n'hésitez pas. Je m'intéresse vraiment aux enjeux de gouvernance liés à la transformation, mais pour ça, il faut s'appuyer sur la modélisation, il faut s'appuyer sur les données et s'appuyer sur des analyses, des enjeux liés à la transformation de notre économie, à la transformation de notre de la structure énergétique et de la structure de notre société. Donc, c'est vraiment des thèmes là, qui m'intéressent et on travaille à toutes sortes de niveaux avec des analyses très sectorielles associées avec l'accélérateur de transition. On regarde des secteurs économiques particuliers et on travaille avec des gens de ces secteurs-là pour décarboner, puis avec des analyses un peu plus en retrait. Et ça sera donc le sujet de la première conférence, la conférence que je vais donner dans quelques semaines. On sort demain la deuxième édition des perspectives énergétiques pour le Canada. C'est de la modélisation technico-économique qu'on fait, où on modélise l'ensemble du système énergétique au Canada, donc production, les coûts, les productions, les technologies de transformation, les technologies d'utilisation d'énergie. Et on évalue un peu qu'est-ce que ça représente d'atteindre les objectifs climatiques. Et le rapport sera publié demain, on le présentera là, dans quelques semaines. Je veux juste dire une des choses, c'est ce qu'on découvre avec la modélisation, c'est à quel point le changement de réduction importante des émissions de gaz à effet de serre à carboneutralité affecte complètement la façon dont on doit agir pour atteindre ces objectifs-là. Donc, changer la cible de 80 % de réduction à 100 % implique de repenser les approches et montre que certaines trajectoires qui semblaient acceptables il y a quelques années sont plus acceptables. Et c'est vraiment ce genre de transformation en profondeur, de changements de cibles qui ont l'air juste quantitatives, qui sont intéressantes de découvrir quand on fait ces analyses-là et quand on s'appuie sur la modélisation. Donc, je ne me rappelle plus la date exacte, là, donc peut-être Damien a la date, là, mais ça sera dans quelques semaines qu'on présentera ça.
Je ne le rappelle non plus. Stay tuned. We will send you an announcement. So we're going to move to some student presentations next, but maybe I'll just pause and ask if anyone has any questions about the program or about anything you've heard so far. You can also, of course, save questions for later on in the event as well. So our first student presenter is going to be on Zoom. So Catherine Détrempe, I believe you are out there somewhere. If you want to unmute yourself and share your screen, you can go ahead.
Thank you, Damon. So I hope everybody can hear me clear. I will try to share my screen with you. Okay, so everybody should be able to see my screen right now. Okay, so hi everyone. My name is Catherine, and today I'm gonna present you a little bit of my master project. So I'm a master's student, it's my second year. I'm in Elena Bennett's lab, and my project is about modeling the impact of restoration in the Monte Rigi. So for those of you that are not familiar with the Monte Rigi area, it's in the southern east of Quebec, close to the Montreal Island. And overall, more than half of its landscape is agriculture. In the last few years, there's been a lot of push in the Monte Rigi to actually increase the amount of natural space and natural habitat in this agricultural landscape. But this created a trade-off because it reduced the area that are available for crop production. But what if I told you that restoration and reforestation could be a viable solution to maintain our current crop production in the Monte Rigi while increasing natural habitat and the related environmental benefit? Well, this is an actual possibility, and this is what my research is about. Because if you look closely into this slide, currently there's a lot of agricultural field in the Monte Rigi that are abandoned. And these abandoned fields represent a tremendous potential if they were to be restored to produce both benefit to the farmer and to the environment. And this is what my research is about for my master. My research is about looking at what would be the impact if we were to restore these abandoned fields on the production of diverse ecosystem services, such as crop production, water filtration, and many other. And how would that influence the resilience of the Monte Rigi agricultural landscape? So in order to do this project, I will create three types of restoration scenario, where 2%, 8%, and 70% of the field will be restored. 8% is what you see presently on the future slide. and 70% increase in green cover is the actual policy goal of the Communauté métropolitaine de Montréal, which encompasses a small fraction of the Montérégie landscape. Therefore, by creating this restoration scenario, I would be able to forecast if we were to apply this 70% increase to the entire Montérégie landscape, what would be the impact on the production of ecosystem services, but also on the resilience of our agricultural landscape. But in order to be able to quantify this impact, I will use statistical model to predict how the restoration of these abandoned fields will impact ecosystem services and resilience. This will allow me to generate some map of the abandoned field in Montérégie, map that presently are non-existent. And it will allow me to illustrate how small restoration action can have an overall greater impact on the provision of ecosystem services and resilience. I hope that these maps will help the decision maker in the future to see that we can both increase resilience and ecosystem services while maintaining our current crop production. So this is my project. And if you have a question later on, I will be happy to answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Catherine. So I think we'll just go through, we have, I think, 8 students who are gonna do a quick presentation. So we'll go through all of them and then allow a bit of time for questions at the end, if there are any. So next we have Chris Luderitz, who is a postdoc at McGill working with Catherine Potvin and Dror Etzion, who is a collaborator in the program. So you need the microphone. Right. You have to hold it quite close to your mouth.
All right. Hey, everyone.
A little closer.
Closer, like yeah. This? Okay. Perfect. Hey, everyone. Quite excited to be here in person. So I will be talking about Pivot, which is a collaborative project between the NFB, the National Film Board of Canada, and researchers at the McGill Sustainability Initiative. And I very briefly will present you some, hopefully also some research findings, if this cooperates. No? All right, give us a second here as we figure this out. I know. How about next? Like this, yeah, okay. So the goal of Pivot is really to amplify the voices of small business owners as they transition towards sustainability. But Pivot is actually as much a research project as it is a social or like an action research project. So it means that we really try to use social networks and peer support to leverage and support small business owners as much as we actually are interested in studying these processes. So the core of Pivot is actually a website that you can also go and look at gopivot.org. And on the left side here, you can see the interface, but that is only part, as I mentioned, of Pivot. And the other part is sort of the research design where we have different stories about essentially the same entrepreneur, which we can then sort of test to what extent they resonate with people and whether or not, for example, narratives about money, say the business case, is actually more compelling to businesses than say if we emphasize, for example, environmental protection or sort of the social passion and entrepreneurship. So if you go to our website, it will look to you like this, where you get a variety of stories, but it can also look to you like this because you will be randomly selected to a different setting. For example, here you can only see stories about and the environmental aspects and climate action. So these are all different sort of settings that we can randomly select users to and then they can sort of interact with those settings. And we can obviously study them. And this is just like a very preliminary finding. But what is quite interesting that across these narratives, it seems actually that it's not so much the money that interests business owners to learn about climate action, but it is much more they're much more motivated by sort of environmental components or the ability to protect The climate and the environment, as well as the social engagement. So I will leave you with this. Right after me, Madeleine will present as well. She is a master's student, just finishing up her master thesis, and she will talk a little bit more about some aspects of our project. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Chris. So Madeleine, Madeleine is on Zoom somewhere, I believe. If you want to come in next, then we can stop the share.
Hi, everyone. I'll share my screen. You should be able to see my screen and hear my voice now. So yes, my name is Madeleine, and I'm also part of the Pivot project. And I looked at the resilience of the Pivot SMEs in times of crisis, because as you know, we are in time of pandemic. Just quick highlights of the program. I did my internship at Pop Culture et Numérique, where I learned how to do community management and social media outreach, which was really complementary to what I learned in biology and totally new for me. And the summer school at Concordia was a great way to learn about different tools on climate change, but also how to bring them into your own field. And there was a lot of activities that taught us how to think creatively, which was really rich. And of course, the cohort of diverse students from different backgrounds, universities, that was really great. So when the COVID pandemic hit, SMEs all around the world were highly impacted, obviously. And it got us thinking, how are they reacting to this crisis? Are they maintaining an environmental mindset, or are they only focusing on the survival mode? And so I did a before and after analysis using 17 interviews that were done before COVID and follow-up interviews that were done at the beginning of COVID. And then last April, I had focus group activities. I led them through like discussions on Zoom, and we were able to identify three opportunities of sustainable initiatives in times of COVID. We have three main leverages at different levels of society, which is quite interesting. They are acting at the macro, meso, and micro levels of society. So at the macro level, SMEs were advocating for systemic change, asking for green recovery, clearly asking for climate action within policies and having a plan of action like COVID, but for sustainability. So it was really clear that they wanted the government to move forward with sustainability. At the meso level, SMEs were answering new needs for society, so pivoting their action, but also while adopting a sustainability approach. So they were doing deliveries, but using electrical vehicles, or they were using fabrics that they already had and developing new collaborations with locals to make sure that we would have masks. And so they were actually reducing the transport and making their supply chain really tight in times of COVID. At the micro level, they were trying to change clients' behavior and using the buy local momentum that was really high, and weaving the sustainability message within this momentum. It was quite interesting to see them acting within those three spheres of society, always with this environmental focus. So in brief, the Pivot SMEs, they maintained an environmental mindset in times of COVID. And it was quite surprising to see that they were resilient and innovative. And that's why they should be included in the Canadian ecological transition. So within this micro, meso, and macro levels of society, they are really key actors that can generate transformation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madeleine. So our next presenter is Lillian Sales, who is working with Pedro Perez Neto's group. And will be joining us on Zoom. And one of the things that we have learned now, Concordia has two campuses here downtown and also at Loyola. And Lillian is at Loyola campus by accident, but fortunately is able to Zoom into the meeting. We'll be presenting from Loyola.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Good morning. Let me share my screen. Good morning. My name is Lillian. I am a Benzing postdoctoral fellow at Concordia University. And basically what I've been working with in the last 6 years is how biodiversity is going to change in the future and how has human impact already affected biodiversity at a global scale. So we know that since the Industrial Revolution, humans have affected the environment, including the climate, at a greater magnitude than what has ever been experienced in the fossil and in the paleo record. Since the second half of the last century, these changes have been magnified. Into the future, we expect greater changes in temperature, with global temperature being increasing, changes in precipitation regimes and the frequency of droughts and extreme events, just like hurricanes and extreme fire events, even with the melting of the glaciers and the increase of sea level. All these changes on themselves are changes in the environment, but they will, and they have been affecting species and their distributions. So what I'm mostly interested about and what I've been trying to focus my research now and in the past is on how these changes are already affecting species distribution, their interactions, and the ecosystem services that they provide, because everything is connected. Species form networks within themselves, and that affects not only them, but us. And in my project, I will try to evaluate how the redistribution of biodiversity under climate change and under different environmental changes affect the way species distribute, the way species interact with each other, and how that cascades into ecosystem level changes. Basically, this is what I've been trying to do. I'll be happy to discuss these issues any further in detail at a later moment. Thank you. And sorry about the mistake.
No worries. It's an excellent test of our hybrid meeting capabilities. So we're going to have a couple of in-person presenters next. I believe first will be Melisande, who is a graduate student working with Joshua Bengio at Université de Montréal. So she's going to speak a little bit about her work. So yes, you need to use the mic. You can speak in either language. Just hold the microphone close to your.
Bonjour. Donc, je m'appelle Mélisande et je suis étudiante en deuxième année au doctorat en informatique à l'Université de Montréal et à MILA. Et je m'intéresse aux applications environnementales de l'intelligence artificielle. J'ai choisi de rejoindre le programme LIEN-D parce que je voulais comprendre comment, en tant que scientifique, je peux participer à la définition de politique publique et plus particulièrement de politique environnementale. Et parce qu'il y a toujours un fossé entre la recherche en laboratoire, l'implémentation, et puis ensuite, comment est-ce que les travaux de recherche sont utilisés pour informer les décisions en matière de politique publique. Et donc, je voudrais aussi remercier toute l'équipe de Future Earth avec qui j'ai fait mon stage cet été. C'était vraiment très, très bien. Donc, mon projet de recherche actuel se rapporte à la question de la protection de la biodiversité. Donc, en fait, comme l'a expliqué Liliane juste avant, la perte de biodiversité est une crise écologique très importante. Si on regarde juste les espèces d'oiseaux qui sont quasi menacées d'extinction, en fait, il y avait 1 millier qui étaient reportés en tant que tels en 2021. Et si on compare ça aux 1200 espèces d'oiseaux présentes aux États-Unis, on se rend compte que c'est un nombre quand même assez affolant. Et puis, au-delà de la valeur intrinsèque de la biodiversité, la perte de biodiversité entraîne des changements dans les services écosystémiques, que ce soit en termes d'approvisionnement avec la nourriture ou de régulation avec le stockage de carbone. Donc, ça affecte tout le monde. Et qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire pour ça? En fait, une première étape, c'est de comprendre quel est l'état actuel de la biodiversité. Donc, idéalement, on aimerait comprendre où sont les espèces dans le monde. Et en fait, plus que de comprendre la correspondance géographique de la distribution des espèces, il s'agit de comprendre la relation entre les espèces et leur habitat. En effet, l'habitat, c'est un peu différent de la géographie parce que ça peut avoir une résolution spatiale très différente. Ça peut être un climat ou ça peut être tel arbre spécifique à tel endroit dans le monde qui a une telle hauteur qui va abriter un certain type d'espèce. L'idée, c'est... pour pouvoir faire ça, on veut donc modéliser quelle est la distribution des espèces. Dans les modèles actuels utilisés en écologie, ce qui est utilisé, ce sont des variables environnementales telles que des données climatiques, l'utilisation des types de sols. Mais une des limites de ces modèles, c'est d'une part dans les données qui sont utilisées parce qu'elles ne sont pas forcément disponibles partout dans le monde à la même résolution. Et aussi, la plupart du temps, ils sont très effectifs pour étudier une espèce en particulier ou une région particulière dans le monde, ce qui ne nous permet pas de faire cette cartographie complète des différentes espèces. Donc là où notre équipe a identifié une opportunité, c'est dans le type de données qu'on peut utiliser. En effet, maintenant, on a accès à de nombreuses autres sources de données, telles que les images satellites ou les données de sciences citoyennes. Et en fait, c'est là qu'une approche par apprentissage automatique va être intéressante. En effet, dans les images satellites, on les a partout dans le monde et elles contiennent des informations très riches. L'idée sous-jacente du projet, c'est que dans les images satellites, on va avoir de l'information sur l'habitat qui va être encodée dedans. Et ce n'est pas déraisonnable de penser ça parce que, par exemple, si on combine les bandes infrarouges et rouges des images satellites, on peut avoir un index de végétation qui va nous dire si la végétation est saine. Donc, on se dit que dans les images satellites, on a de l'information sur l'habitat. Dans mon projet, je cherche à construire un modèle qui, à partir des images satellites, va prédire la distribution de toutes les espèces. Pour l'instant, toutes les espèces, les espèces d'oiseaux les plus fréquentes aux États-Unis, ce qui représente quand même 684 espèces d'oiseaux. Et en fait, ce que mon modèle permettrait de faire, ce serait non seulement prédire à partir d'images satellites la distribution des espèces, mais aussi de pouvoir prendre en compte le cas où on a les images satellites et de l'information partielle sur certaines espèces. Donc typiquement, par exemple, on pourrait se dire que si on a de l'information sur les oiseaux, eh bien, en fait, ça pourrait nous aider à prédire la distribution des papillons. Et ça, ce n'est pas quelque chose qui est traditionnellement fait dans le domaine de l'écologie. Donc, les prochaines étapes, ce serait évidemment d'étendre ces travaux à d'autres espèces. Je n'ai pas le temps de rentrer dans tous les détails du modèle d'apprentissage automatique, mais je serais ravie de vous en parler, si vous voulez. Voilà, merci beaucoup.
Thank you. So next, we have Mitchell. You want to come up and say a few words?
Hi, everybody. My name is Mitchell Dickow, and I'm a PhD student supervised by Damon, and I'm a member of the Matthews Climate Lab, which focuses on climate scenarios, impacts, and modeling. And I'm going to briefly discuss a little bit of my own research and some of the research going on in our lab, and talk a little bit about my experience with LIEN-D this past year. So my primary research focus is on the concept of a remaining carbon budget, which defines the amount of CO2 that can be emitted while staying below chosen temperature thresholds, such as 1.5 degrees or well below 2 degrees. A lot of the uncertainty associated with remaining carbon budget estimates has to do it originates from one source, and that is how much non-CO2 heat trapping gases, such as methane and nitrous oxide, will be emitted in the future. So one of the goals of my research is to better understand how different future non-CO2 emissions pathways affect the size of the remaining carbon budget. I am also interested in alternative metrics to communicate climate change that may be more relatable to the public than global metrics that are currently used, such as global mean temperature increase. So an example of this is a study published by some colleagues in the lab and I last year. We were able to demonstrate that the length of the outdoor skating season in Montreal will decline in the future as a result of climate change, but the degree to which the skating season declines depends on how quickly we are able to decarbonize. Some other research themes in the CSIM lab include assessing whether corporate emissions reduction pledges are consistent with international goals, such as those of the Paris Agreement. Another research theme is assessing the potential of natural climate solutions as a tool for climate mitigation. And finally, another theme is exploring how to distribute the remaining carbon budget at sub-global scales in a way that is equitable and fair. Our lab has also participated in public outreach and climate change education initiatives. So for instance, we have hosted virtual climate science workshops, and we are currently developing a web application tool named Pledge to LIEN-D. The goal of this tool is to help people understand the implications of their consumption on emissions and encourage individual action to reduce emissions. As a part of our focus on climate change education, our lab has also developed a climate clock, which demonstrates how quickly we will reach 1.5 degrees of warming based off current emissions trajectories. So having been a part of LIEN-D for a year now, I just wanted to briefly share a bit about my experience. So for me, I think the highlight of LIEN-D this past year was the summer school class that took place this past May. So my classmates and I, we were introduced to applying machine learning methods to data analysis, and we had the opportunity to attend workshops introducing us to tools such as Google Earth Engine and Jupyter Notebooks. And I found that these tools that we were introduced to have been very helpful in my own research, and I really appreciated the diversity of research interests amongst our group and the opportunities we had to learn about other research occurring in the LIEN-D program. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Mitchell. Next, Camille.
Hi, everyone. So I didn't know I had the opportunity to do that in French, so I wrote everything in English. So sorry. Sorry for my accent and everything. And the paper and everything. So hi, my name is Camille, and I'm working on missing data management strategies involving value judgment in life cycle assessment. So life cycle assessment, is a multi-criteria environmental impact modeling methodology used to assess environmental impact associated with all the stages of a project. We say from cradle to grave, from resource extraction, to disposal or recycling. It's one of the methods we used to measure sustainability. As in any modeling method, the reliability of the results obtained in LCA, so life cycle assessment, depends on the quality of the data we used. And my research was originally about sand extraction, and it was a master's degree. It was about sand extraction and depletion. And because sand is everywhere in our industries, sand depletion is quite a concern. And in context of natural resource extraction, data reliability is a recurring problem. This makes characterization hazardous and sometimes impossible, while the impacts are clearly visible, and they cannot be ignored. So the analysis of the impacts related to sand exploitation is very characteristic of the problem. Sand is an essential component of concrete, and it's found everywhere in our industry. So for this reason, it is one of the most used resources in the world. the second after water, actually. For a long time, sand reserves seem to be infinite, 120 million billion tons, and it's a very big number, according to some scientists. But in recent years, a clear sign of depletion have been noted everywhere. In some parts of the world, sand has become a resource causing geopolitical conflicts, or it's been controlled by local mafia, like in India, for example. And around the world, studies on local environmental impacts due to sand extraction are being published. So now, in my master's degree, I have a real problem. Clearly, there is a depletion and all kinds of impacts over the world, but I can't assess them because I don't have any data. I don't know how much I have. I don't know how much sand I'm using. I don't know how major the depletion will be, or even if it's going to be one. But the impacts are there. I see them. If I analyze this depletion from the available data, then the answer is clear. There is no impact, no data, no problem. But LCA is a decisional support tool. And how can I help someone make a relevant decision if I can fully assess those impacts? And so all along my master's degree, I set up compensation strategies that allowed me to manufacture data from all kinds of literature. Because I knew I couldn't turn in a report stating that everything was fine. But what it is worth in terms of reliability of results? Not much. Better than nothing, which is what I had before. And so that's where my master's turned into a PhD. Is my personal judgment as an expert a valid strategy to implement environmental modeling? Because I knew the problem was real, I made the decision to create data from journalistic reports. How often do LCA practitioners use their personal judgment in their analysis? And what kind of choices do they make? So now the objective of my PhD is to study the strategies implemented by LCA practitioners to overcome the lack of reliable data in life cycle impact assessment that involve value judgment, while allowing them to produce reliable and relevant studies in terms of decision making. So I'm going to talk now a little bit about LIEN-D and how I found this program extremely interesting. For me, the LIEN-D program has been a great opportunity because today everything comes down to the fact of being able to work together, whatever our background or research field is. And LIEN-D allowed me to meet researchers and students from very different fields to participate in many conferences and training workshop and classes. So it's been really interesting. And then digital technology in terms of data collecting, it's quite the tool we have to use. So it's a bit part of my research too. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Camille. So I believe our next presenter is joining us on Zoom. So Africa, if you are out there somewhere.
Yes, hi. Let me share my screen. Can you hear me?
Yes, perfect.
Yeah, perfect, thank you. So I will present a little bit about the research that I have been doing and the current research that I'm doing at the Cardiff Lab. I am a PhD student at McGill University, supervised by Jeff Cardiff. And just a little bit of background of the type of work that I have been doing. Mostly focusing on the use of satellite data for environmental monitoring and forecasting. One of the areas of interest for my research has been Lake Atitlan. I'm originally from Guatemala. Lake Atitlan is located in Guatemala. And I always say that it is the most beautiful lake in the world, no bias because I'm from there, but actually it is. It's surrounded by volcanoes. It's an excellent example of an oligotrophic lake, which are very few. But since 2009, it started suffering algae blooms. And with a multi-sensor approach, we were able to monitor the first major algae bloom that occurred that year. And since then, algae blooms had been occurring in this lake on the more regular basis. So from an empirical analysis using satellite data to monitor the extent of these algae blooms in 2009, I developed an algorithm to transition from a qualitative analysis to a quantitative one to derive chlorophyll concentration used from satellite data. And here we use a combination of in situ observations with satellite data. So every time now that we have an optical image, we can derive chlorophyll concentration, which is used as a proxy of algae bloom event. And this continuous monitoring of the lake also led to additional questions and additional understanding of what was happening over there. First, we noticed that algae blooms were more frequent. And also when they were happening, usually they were happening at the end of the rainy season. This is a unique area with a unique ecosystem. There are a lot of endemic species over here as well. This is an endorheic watershed that is surrounded by volcanoes, and it has its own weather patterns, in fact. So it is a relatively high location, just in general, where Guatemala is located in the tropics. And this is a temperate lake. And in the winter season or rainy season, you know how winter is, there is a mixing of waters in the lake because the surface temperature decreases and is very similar to the rest of the temperature in the profile of the water of the lake. We already have algae bloomed or cyanobacteria presence in the lake, and we have a mixing of waters. And at the end of the rainy season, there has been enough runoff that has been discharged over the lake, in addition to this mixing of the water that makes the cyanobacteria spread throughout the lake. And then we have enough solar radiation, so we have enough conditions for algae blooms to occur. So with this information, we tried to test this to actually see if this was contributing to the presence of algae blooms in Lake Atitlan and being able to forecast them. So we use a combination of environmental variables that could give us information about temperature and precipitation runoff, and other variables, and analyze all this data with several machine learning algorithms to create a model that could predict chlorophyll algae blooms events in this lake. And we already got some results. We have a model, and we are working on the operationalization of this system. Some key highlights of this type of research is that, for example, with the monitoring of algae blooms in Lake Atitlan, it was possible to inform policy and drive resources to this particular area. Once the algae blooms start happening in Lake Atitlan and through the research that has been done, we were able to highlight the issue and specific water policies were put in place in Guatemala because they did not exist previously. And all of that was informed by the knowledge that this lake was deteriorating. This is the second most visited site in Guatemala. So it was extreme relevance to know that algae blooms were happening and continue happening, and just the threat that we may lose this tourist attraction in the near future if we don't take action. In addition to that, the current research that I'm doing at the lab is related to forest monitoring using a combination of satellite data that include radar and optical information. All of these with the purpose of enhanced forest monitoring systems in the tropics. Nowadays, we have an incredible amount of satellite data, particularly on the optical spectrum, in which for free, almost every 5 to 2 days, we have an image, but that doesn't mean that we have a valid observation. This is a satellite image over the tropics, specifically Brazil. This is how it looks. And if we want to understand what is going on in this landscape, cloud cover is a major issue. So there is an additional data set that has been available since 2014, which is SAR, Synthetic Aperture Radar. And every time that we have an image from radar, we have an observation regardless of the weather conditions. And in the lab, we are analyzing this information to inform and enhance near real-time forest monitoring systems. And there are challenges because the data is not that easy to understand and process. We are looking different information compared to optical data. Mainly we see a structure and humidity of the surface, and it varies depending on the wetland that we are using for this sensor. And currently this is what it has kept me all night, analyzing this information and see how we can better inform forest monitoring and forest degradation processes in the tropics. And this is just a brief summary of what we have been doing. And I'm constantly challenged by Jeff to have a question and then to think of an additional dimension on how to process large amounts of big data to have a more complete picture of what is going on and how we can use SAR to better inform forest monitoring systems. But that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Africa. So our last presenter is Alex, who is here somewhere. Yes. Who has brought a prop, I see.
Hey everybody, my name is Alex Pache. I'm a PhD student here at Concordia. And my work for my PhD is reproducing past environmental conditions in central Quebec with tree rings. So reproducing past conditions, environmental conditions in general, is important to sustainably manage the environment. And for climate change specifically, we need context to know whether climate change is actually affecting a region because it's so regionally variable. So we need the long climate records to do that, because we want to know whether when it's getting warmer or drier, whether it's actually going past the natural range of that environment. Now, in most areas, we don't have climate records that are long enough to do that. So something that we can do is use tree rings and other proxies to supplement that data and get farther back into time and give us context. So trees allow us to do that because they put on a ring of growth every year, and that ring of growth in the right conditions is controlled by the climate. And I'm doing temperature specifically for my PhD. And so trees that grow at the top of mountains, for example, at tree line where trees are stressed and they're almost not growing anymore, they sort of become like almost thermometers. We have to manipulate the data enough statistically and with machine learning and other things. But just as an example, this is a black spruce that's around 7 years old growing in the valley in the Gaspésie. This is growing at tree line. It's 170 or 160 years old. So it's almost 100, it's about 100 years older than the other one. And this one grows a lot slower and it's a lot more sensitive. So the years that it's warm, it'll have thicker rings. So we sample hundreds of trees like this at the top of mountains, and it allows us to reconstruct the past temperature and give us context. So it's just for some pictures, this is at the top of a mountain, my colleague Claire sampling one of these trees. On the right, you could see how stressed out these trees are at the top of the mountain. And what this allows us all to do is make something like this, which is a climate reconstruction in black. In red is the actual instrumental data, which only goes around to 1950. So we're able to model it. And through LIEN-D, I was actually able to further understand that the machine learning processes behind this, and it kind of inspired me to look into neural networks as well for creating these models. And otherwise, the rest of my project is, well, this was specifically in the Gaspésie, but I'm doing it in other areas in central Quebec, like Limoncou and Mont-Élie, which they're in important ecological regions. And then for the rest of my project, this area that you could see circled in the Bas-Saint-Laurent, we're reproducing the past ecology, forest ecology, using tree rings as well, in collaboration with Dominique Arsenault at UCOR. And what we're doing there is most of the lakes in southern Quebec have been, the forests around them have been completely destroyed for logging. And this was happened before forest roads or forestry roads or anything. They would just flood them. They would dam them, flood them, and then harvest all the wood around it. So we don't really know what the forests used to be like before. But luckily, there's a couple lakes in this area that were saved from this process. And so we're studying the trees there and studying the trees that had fallen in the lake and have been preserved for hundreds of years, and studying their rings and the ecology to help inform forest restoration so that the forests are actually more like how they were naturally in the past. And that's it for my PhD presentation. But I'm also going to present for our lab. So our lab is at Concordia in the Geography, Planning, and Environment Department. It's called CHAPL, stands for the Climatology, Hydrology, and Paleo Environmental Lab. And it's headed by Dr. Janine Marie Saint-Jacques. She wasn't able to be here today, unfortunately. And what we do basically is try to reproduce past environmental conditions so we know how to better plan for the future. Now, these are some important papers that have been published by Dr. Janine Marie Saint-Jacques recently. And it's basically like some databases to understand the past temperature records of the past thousands of years, and as well as important reconstructions of river flow in the Mississippi, which is a really important river in North America. Then we have my project, as well as Claire O'Neill Sanger's projects, which it helps us understand recent wildlife and forest sustainability contexts in Quebec. And so I did a moisture reconstruction for my master's, which allowed us to understand what the moisture availability in Parc National de la Gaspésie was like. And there they have a really endangered subpopulation of caribou that is their success is related to how much snow there was, and our reconstruction is related to how much snow there was. So it's being used to help understand how we could save the subpopulation. Then Claire's work at the bottom, using the mud at the bottom of a lake, we were able to reconstruct what the forest was like for the past 2000 years. So what you see in this graph here at the bottom is pollen records for the past few thousand years. And with that, we could see how the forests have changed, which is related to temperature, as well as other things. And another interesting thing about that is that we were able to see a pre-colonial agricultural signal. So a change in pollen because indigenous groups in the area were practicing agriculture before even colonial powers were here. And other things happening in the lab are reconstructing what forests used to be like in the Maritimes using forestry records. So they used to just go along plots and write down the trees every certain amount of meters that were around. And so what we're doing is using that to reconstruct what the forest used to look like and filling out important gaps in the Maritimes where it hasn't been done yet. So you can see in this map here, these red areas are where we're filling in some information. And other than that, we're also studying how storms used to affect central Quebec and that will inform sustainable management in that area as well, and also flooding on the West Coast. And so our lab really has a huge variety of stuff that we're doing. And it's a really excellent lab that I'm grateful to be part of. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex. So that's it for the presentation section of today's event. I'm going to invite anyone who has a question for one of the speakers to either send it directly to them via the chat. That might be the most effective way to reach out, or to send it to the entire group. I think what we'll do next is actually to move to breakout rooms directly. And I had imagined that we would try to have hybrid breakout rooms with some people in person and some people on Zoom. I think maybe that's the next goal for our events. So for the moment, we're going to stick with our Zoom participants. We're going to organize 3 breakout rooms, and then those of us who are here in person will break out also into 2 groups. I would say, so you know, the intent here is for you to introduce yourselves in a smaller group, but also please feel free to offer ideas or suggestions for the program. We have a year coming up and lots of opportunity to invite speakers or organize events that would be of interest to you in the program. And so in the Zoom groups, there's going to be, so I've asked Eliane, Allison, and Andrea from Future Earth and Sustainability in the Digital Age to facilitate those group discussions. And those of us here in person will self-organize into groups, probably staying on the side of the room that you're already in, so we don't have to move around too much. So we'll take about 15 or 20 minutes in breakout rooms, and then we'll come back and have a quick closing discussion.
All right, thanks, Damon. And folks, for those of you in Zoom, I think we're sending you in randomly into the breakout rooms. So do let us know if any changes need to be made and you'd like to be moved around. Douglas and I are here. Douglas appears as camera. You can just speak to us directly and we'll make it happen for you. For those of you in the space, as Damon suggested, you're welcome to stay where you are. Otherwise, there are tables set up throughout the space. If you want to navigate to those areas, like where I'm seated, there's one in the corner. If you find that more comfortable to sit around a table, it's entirely up to you. I leave it to you to decide. Thanks.
Welcome to get up and move around. But maybe, Sarah, would you kind of take this group to Cecile? You can...
Yeah, you have to meet that.
think anyone can hear me on Zoom. Yes.
I can hear you, Damon. Yeah. We can hear you.
Okay, excellent. Uh-huh. Okay, so welcome back, everyone. So we'll just do a quick report back from the discussions. Maybe since Pierre is here, I'll ask him to start.
So hi, everyone. I'm Pierre Chouard. I'm the LIEN-D program coordinator. So we had a little in-person breakout room, let's say. So what came out really from what would you like to see in LIEN-D this year, in terms of symposium activities and so on. So we mentioned something on artificial intelligence. So because we're such a diverse group, people coming more from the natural science side of things are really interested in learning about such tools. So artificial intelligence and vice versa. So people from computer science would like to know more about, let's say, ecology. So maybe something about bridging the two together, being in one event or two. Same about life cycle assessment. So lots of interest there as well, and trying to maybe incorporate or learn more about how it's done. And this led us as well to talk about having a space or a day to have interdisciplinary activities or try to connect, maybe have some ideas for collaborations, panels, brainstorming day in general. So I think today's all the different talks really kind of triggered a lot of interest in everyone. And some people want to talk more. And if we don't have a day to do so, maybe then we forget and we only think about it the next year. So have maybe a day to do this. Also learn more about digital tools in general. So not only AI, but let's say modeling and other digital innovations really that could be used in anyone's research. Finally, we also talked about a symposium on science communication overall, and maybe something more specific about how, since we even have artists that are here today, I saw on Zoom, how we communicate our work to the general public and how we just synthesize our work, being it a research manuscript, a book, an art piece. So trying to have something, an event around this diversity of outreach. And finally, also have an event probably with Future Earth, that would be great, and SDA, talking about the SDGs in general, because a lot of LIEN-D is, you know, part of it is based on those goals. And, you know, with COP coming in Scotland soon, I think it would be of great interest to everyone to talk more about the diversity of these goals. So that's it for our group. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Pierre. Maybe we'll go to one of the groups on Zoom. LIEN-D, would you like, or someone from your group, to say a few words about what you discussed?
One of the things we discussed was really, well, first of all, we kind of just shared the various backgrounds and how we're connected to LIEN-D, and also how has LIEN-D and involvement in LIEN-D led to the identification of new tools to work with at the interface of digitalization and sustainability? And what was interesting was how COVID-19 disrupted everything, led to interesting pathways that either led to discovering new tools, creating new tools, and that the possibility of interacting online through LIEN-D also created opportunities to access new networks and expand the work in ways that had to be done because of the difficulty of being able to do field work under COVID-19. So it was interesting in terms of I think Madeline was talking about her internship with Pivot, but really the big idea was how people had to pivot because of COVID-19 and how LIEN-D was helpful in that pivoting, and also exploring what are new ways that can be used in terms of learning from other people's experience, how they were able to take advantage of this and being able to continue to leverage the networks through LIEN-D, and also the opportunity to interact with the different universities in Montreal, and how that's been also critical to helping students just expand their worldviews and also have ideas to help them build their thesis as they move forward. So those are the kind of things we talked about. If anybody in my group wants to add something, please go ahead. Great, okay. Back to you, Damien.
Thank you, Eliane. Maybe we'll move to Allison's group. Allison, I don't know if you want to speak or someone else.
Sure, I can go ahead. But after, if there's anything anybody wants to add, please feel free to do so. So we had very specific feedback. So things that we had two collaborators and a couple of researchers, students. So what was great about the project was the different internship opportunities and how they were particularly interesting, but also how they were able to incorporate their internship work into their own research projects and how that enriched their own projects. That the LIEN-D program, they were able to attend talks and workshops that they wouldn't have heard of or been able to, you know, access in any other type of way. So instead of being focused in their own specific field or sector, really exploring other fields. And just the quality of the workshops that were given. So in terms of some things that could be slightly improved. So, I mean, it was noted that it was LIEN-D's first year, but maybe understanding a bit more ahead of time, ahead of the year, like what's the reporting process for students, that kind of administrative load, because there was a bit of fuzziness, but it was noted that since Pierre has been there, like things have been much clearer. And for new students coming in, she didn't feel that. So I think that's beautiful progress just there to be noted. And then in terms of opportunities, so there was a lot of interest in connecting students more with what was happening at the Canadian policy level. And they were very keen on understanding more and attending the CSBC town halls and their annual meeting, and how could they build greater links to that community. So that was another area. And I had two great collaborators on the breakout session. And what was noted was that there seemed to be maybe a bit of a lack of getting information from what was happening from LIEN-D. So maybe enhancing communication specifically to collaborators and maybe more engaging with them, understanding what their projects are, what they're doing, because they had a lot of ideas on how to engage with LIEN-D and how to connect with building initiatives that we're doing, like with the SDA and Future Earth and other different types of initiatives, even with CSPC, because they're working at that level as well. And also trying to understand how can they engage their own students, even if they're just even if that they're at the collaborator level, how can they better engage their own students with what LIEN-D is doing. So if I haven't captured everything, please go ahead.
Thank you, Allison. I mean, that's really great feedback. Maybe we'll go to the other group that was in this room. Sarah, if you want to come up.
Yeah, so we had a nice conversation in a circle over here in person. And there was some positive feedback around the participants really enjoyed the summer school and the speaker series and the leadership training. And there were some really good suggestions coming out of this group for the coming year, including focusing even more on collective leadership and building those skills, and also on science communication, and on building the LIEN-D community as well. So There were some really good suggestions just around increasing the website capacity. So having student profiles and lab profiles, maybe a directory, ways of getting to know each other through the website and through other online tools, like perhaps a Slack or maybe even Teams. There was a lot of support for having more workshops and kind of hands-on engaged formats of like working with each other and building skills in a hands-on way. So like even role-playing and gameplay and leadership training for, it would be an example of that. And just looking through, there was a really good suggestion that there would be ways of engaging within the group or subgroups to come up with publications as well and publish together in an interdisciplinary format. And looking at ways of kind of, yeah, just connecting more and keeping track of our experiences with leads. And I guess Alex Pache finished with saying that he really appreciated the sort of inspiration to learn more about diverse fields that has come out of LIEN-D, including like neural networks. And so, yeah, it's a nice conversation. Did I miss anything critical?
Okay. Great. So our last Zoom group was Andrea's group. If you'd like to say a few words.
Great. Thanks. We had a great group. We had a mix of old, new students, collaborators, and profs. And we did want to congratulate the organizers of this event. So well done for a hybrid, very cool format. It's great to kind of see people in a room together, even though we couldn't be there. So we heard a few of the things that have been said already. So echoing what Sarah just said, the current LIEN-D students really appreciated those opportunities for leadership skills and leadership seminars and trainings. I'd like to see that continue. Echoing what Pierre said and Sarah said, we had a really good conversation about the need for science communication and that scientists are not good at communicating their science. And can we do this through alternative mediums? How can we do communication through art? How can we include Indigenous perspectives? So I think there's definitely something to build in the program around science communication there. Interdisciplinarity, sort of the convergence of machine learning, AI, ecology. They really appreciated that and like to see that being built up. And then one other kind of practical suggestion was to have maybe thematic working groups so that students who don't necessarily have the same disciplinary backgrounds, but are maybe working on a similar theme, can kind of come together in a broader working group, such that you get that interdisciplinary interaction. Someone said, you know, we could use a working group as a sounding board around a theme. So that was one suggestion that came up. Leadership, interdisciplinarity, science communication, and thematic working groups. If I missed anything from my group, feel free to jump in, but I think that was it. Oh, aussi, on avait deux intervenants en français, donc c'est juste important de souligner que c'est un programme bilingue, puis on a quand même fait la conversation dans les deux langues. Donc, soyez bienvenus de parler dans la langue que vous voulez dans le programme. Merci.
Merci. Merci, Andrea. Thank you, Andrea. Yeah, so I mean, would anyone else like to make any comments or ask questions? Thank you for everyone's feedback and ideas. It's been a strange year, obviously. We were launching this program, which we conceived of, long before the pandemic hit us, and turns out to be somewhat prescient in the sense of we've all been forced into this bizarre online world, I think we've all learned how much can be accomplished by digital platforms. imagine running this event a year and a half ago, you know, it would have been a disaster, right? Some people in the room, 25, 30 people on Zoom. So, you know, we've come a long way in the last year in terms of being able to convene in different spaces and, you know, speak across platforms and also hopefully across disciplines. So, you know, thank you all for being here. I think we can close it here. I will take note of all the suggestions that came out of the discussions, and if anyone else has suggestions, do feel free to reach out to me directly or to Pierre, who has been taking notes of the discussions as well. So yes, thank you all for being here, and I look forward to seeing everyone at our next event, either on Zoom or in person.
Awesome. Thanks, Damon.
Thank you.
And we actually have live applause now. This is so new for us after those virtual claps on Zoom. Anyhow, I'll just, before we close up the Zoom, I just wanted to say a special shout out to, we kind of made this happen last minute here at Four Space working with Damon, and I'm so glad that we were able to rally some folks into the space. Thanks for your patience with some slight technical glitches today, folks, but I'm glad you had a good experience. And for those of you on Zoom, thanks again for joining us, for animating the chat. I'm seeing some nice comments come in, so thanks for that. And just to mention, if any of your friends or colleagues were not able to participate today but had interest or registered initially, this recording of this event is already available right now on YouTube. So you can just look up Concordia University Fourth Space and you'll find our YouTube channel. Otherwise, I'll send a follow-up email to all with the link to that, to all who registered. Okay, thank you for the presentation, students and faculty members here. It was really great. C'était hyper intéressant pour nous tous et nous toutes de vous écouter de cette manière ce matin. Je suis pas encore totalement réveillée là, mais on y arrive. So on that note, we hope to see you soon and continue working with this initiative. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day. Bye.
And a huge thank you to Anna and Doug and Fourth Space for hosting today. Really amazing. I mean, yes, I think most of us couldn't have pulled this off a year and a half ago, but I bet Anna and Doug actually could have in Fourth Space. So thank you so much for a wonderful event. And thanks to Pierre and Damon and everyone else who was involved in organizing.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.
Bye, everyone.